Rusted Legion! Forward!
Can you hear the thunder in the distance? Cannot hide, say goodbye to your existence.
Join the army of flesh and crawl.
Here we roam, this is our world.
We invent your mortal knees. To make a Jarax is your new king.
His upgraded abs are undefeated. Merciless, so alpha demon, no one can defeat this team.
Legion, let me hear you scream! Our enemies fall in the crimson sand. You have no choice but to join our band. Serve Mecha Jurax, this is evil plan.
The Rusted Legion sowing ashes in Outland.
Attention, denizens of Outland! Prepare yourself for the biggest, baddest event this side of the Dark Portal!
Fire Festival?
Incorrect! It's the Fanfire Festival of Music and Vengeance! Vengeance! Coming to the fairgrounds of Hellfire Peninsula over 4 weeks, spanning 5 stages. The Hellfire Festival includes a lineup guaranteed to sizzle your grizzle. Week 1, in Bob's big amphitheater, pirates are invading battlegrounds. A brand new minion class is here to swab your deck, along with 15 new minions and 3 new heroes. And they won't just be at the Hellfire Festival for one show, they'll be here forever. Week 2, in the Cursed Aerocore Pavilion, the one, the only, Alana Starseeker takes the stage in a brand new solo adventure, Trial by Fellfire! See your honor face off against Mecha Jaraxxus and the Rusted Legion!
Your doom awaits!
While she's here, she'll be throwing down with the pirates over in the battlegrounds as a 4th playable hero!
What did he just say?
Then we kick it old school for a special command performance guaranteed to burn your crusade. Charging in week 3 are the Trial by Hellfire Challenges. Relive the hits and slashes, such as Kelthus.
You will not prevail.
MacTheridon.
Die.
And Lady Marge. Co-headlining in week 3 is the baddest brawl to ever blast them all. The return of the Burned! We've added new weapons to hack, slash, and crush your opponent! And speaking of weapons, week 4 on the Rusted Chainsaw stage! You want to be part of the Rusted Legion? Well, you get your chance when you enter the Rumble Dome! Choose a henchman, grab a weapon, and battle for a spot next to Mecha Jaraxxus himself! The glory will be yours, as will Tetnis.
Whatever.
For all attendees of the Hellfire Festival of Music and Vengeance.
Vengeance.
You will have the chance to earn numerous rewards the likes of which Outland has never seen. For all the details, check out the festival flyer. Make it your desktop background. Print it. Get a nice frame and hang it on your wall. Just keep it handy. It's got everything you need to know for joining us at the Hellfire Festival of Music and Vengeance.
Vengeance.
I should never have taught you to self-promote.
We called it the Traveler, and its arrival changed us forever.
Eyes up, Guardian.
You must push back the darkness. Guardians are fighting on Earth and beyond. Join them.
6 of us went down into the pit.
In the end, they all bowed before me.
We have slain his brood. We have murdered his son. And now the Taken King comes for us all.
We thought we were indestructible.
should have been there.
Any last words? I'm coming home, Ace. So, this is to be a reckoning.
For our collapse, our coming back.
We've been waiting.
We are your salvation.
The line between light and dark is so very thin. You're on.
A side should always be taken. Even if it's the wrong side.
This is what I brought you here to see.
Almighty has been reduced to smoldering ash, and with allies like Rasputin, who can stop us?
From Titan to Mercury, their shadow reaches.
Is their message a warning? A trick? We can't know until we hear their words for ourselves.
Weapons. You
will not need them. We offer only truth.
The darkness reached out, but something interferes. The witch sister of the taken king, Savathun.
We are the final line that halts the second collapse.
Prepare yourself, Guardian. This battle is not over.
Where I come from, the Darkness won. I have witnessed this firsthand. I refuse to let it happen again. It's time the truth presented itself to you. Darkness resides within, beckoning you. This is a truth we cannot hide from, and so we must embrace it. The line between light and dark is so very thin. Let's cross it together. I will give these guardians the destruction they crave.
Its shadow across Skyrim. And worse still, I fear there is something more sinister, something more foul, hiding beneath the surface. With every lost soul, our enemy grows stronger. And our need to overcome this evil grows more urgent. We must unite. Gather our allies. And together, we will vanquish this dark heart of Skyrim.
As the eighth entry in the Yakuza series, Yakuza Like a Dragon might seem a bit intimidating, but launching on a whole bunch of different platforms and with a new protagonist and a brand new setting, it's as good a jumping on point as any. Joining me to talk about this brand new game is Scott Strickart, the senior localization producer from Sega on this wonderful series. Scott, thank you for joining us.
Always good to hang out with you, Max.
So, I have been on somewhat on media blackout with Like a Dragon. This is obviously a huge, big new installment that is doing a lot of new stuff with the series. It's already been out in Japan for a little while, but you guys always go a really long way with, you know, how you approach localization. For people who haven't been paying close attention, can you give us a little bit of a rundown of, you know, what the setting is, who the main character is, and what we can expect to see?
Right, so our previous protagonist, Kazuma Kiryu, his story arc ended in Yakuza 6, and we are picking up the new character, Ichiban Kasuga here, the brand new storyline all featuring him. He's our new protagonist, and he's very much a different guy than Kiryu ever was. There's a lot of different things about him that are, where Kiryu is, we all kind of know him. Ichiban's going to hopefully steal everyone's hearts as we get into his story. So His primary story takes place in Yokohama, which is a city kind of adjacent to, it's in Tokyo, but it's, you know, a different suburb. So it's a completely new city for us. It's like three times the size of Kamurocho, and it's going to be pretty cool.
Now, one of the big, huge changes that's happening this time around is that Yakuza, which is, you know, historically a kind of an action beat-em-up, is now a party-based, turn-based RPG. Can you talk a little bit about that and how you're maintaining the same level of expectation for totally over the top action in a, you know, a more of an RPG setting?
Absolutely. So Ichiban is, his story is heavily dependent on his friendships that he makes with these other characters. They're all kind of coming from the same kind of climbing out from rock bottom kind of situations. It's a lot of people kind of from the edges of society coming together. And the dev team really felt like the best way to portray that was to allow the player to play as more than just Ichiban, to really kind of hang their hat on that like friendship thing that's kind of happening with Ichiban. So he's a very charismatic dude, and he attracts people to his kind of demeanor. But at the same time, he's a retro gamer. So these kind of RPG battles that are happening are very much kind of his mindset kind of happening that you're looking at whenever the battles kind of transition. You probably saw that like when the battle transitions, the enemies that are he's fighting literally become like this almost kind of like monsters, and that's all kind of happening in his head being portrayed kind of in the game. But we absolutely haven't forgotten our roots as an action game, and there's all kinds of ways that we're playing heavily to the audience who's expects kind of more quick snappy kind of action. So that's all kind of incorporated into this RPG turn-based system that kind of under the hood will allow you to still kind of perform the action that you will love and know from the Yakuza series.
I dig that. So your party and your friends that you're making, can you talk a bit about how much variety you're going to have in terms of party members and characters you're going to be meeting along the way?
Right. So right now we have the full party of four. You can get up to six plus one party member, optional. And that's going to be one way that you can differentiate your party. But we also have a full-on job system with 19 jobs that you can take up. And, you know, a lot of the times I think when you think of a job system, you're like, all right, you know, here's my thief, my ranger, my mage kind of things. But we're using a classic Yakuza approach for this and allowing you to select like real life jobs. So we'll show some of that gameplay in a bit here, but we'll change all the jobs for the characters. You'll see some of that kind of come into play.
Now, in the previous Yakuza games, you occasionally get different outfits, but they're usually not something you can unlock until later in the game. Are we going to see? I don't know if armor is the right word, but sort of different wardrobe for Ichiban and your party members.
Yes. So each job has its own custom outfit, and then in addition to its own custom outfit has a couple different variations on it. So not only that, there's going to be all kinds of unlockable kind of costumes that, like we always do, that we throw those into the free add-on stuff that like Yakuza does. We're one of the only people who continues to just throw free content post-launch, and those all will have costumes in it.
Now, the setting, I want to talk about this. How would you say it compares, other than just in terms of scale, to some of the previous settings like Sotenbori or Kamurocho?
So Yokohama is a massive port city, and it's got like nine different districts. So you've got the uptown, you've got lowtown, you've got downtown, you've got the commercial district, you've got an industrial district, you've got Koreatown and Chinatown, and all these different like areas kind of have their own vibe and their own feel to them. And what's neat about it is that, you may have noticed as he was playing some of the gameplay that like there's a different threat level to each of those. So like wandering too far and outside of your level is definitely going to be more of a challenge for you, and you're going to have to really kind of pick your strategy better when you're roaming through more dangerous areas.
In terms of enemy variety, we've seen like the wonderful, there's the threatening men, and there's delinquents, and there's various grades of street thugs. How do you maintain that same level within the pageantry of an RPG? Are there going to be, are we going to get fantastical here? Is it going to get really like over the top?
You probably saw that as I was mentioning, like the enemies are literally transform. And that's something that we play into really heavily. There's all kinds of different types of monsters. You add them very early on in the story. You gain what's called a Suji Dex in your as an app on your phone. And if that sounds familiar, there's a reason it does. but so you're basically running around collecting these monsters into your phone app, and they're all very, very kind of homage-y type of enemies to RPGs, while at the same time mixing them with that Yakuza like real life level. So like that guy that changed into a berserker, for instance, that we used a lot of Western names that are they're very much an homage to a very particular series that Ichiban is a fan of called Dragon Quest.
I love that. So this feels like a Yakuza game where you're playing as a JRPG nerd within the game. Like there's that level of like, it seems very meta.
It's a little meta. Yeah, yeah. There's like a whole conversation that Ichiban has with his party members early on. And he's like, guys, did you see those monsters transform? And they're like, no, bro, but whatever it is that you're thinking, like, that's fine as long as it helps you fight.
I guess we've seen, I think I caught a glimpse of Kiryu showing up in one of the trailers or some gameplay. Can you talk about sort of how this is going to intersect with the existing, you know, Yakuza Judgment universe?
So it is definitely set in the same universe. When Ichiban gets out of, Ichiban takes the fall for a crime that he didn't commit, very similar to our previous protagonist. But when he gets out in the year 2019, it's a brand new world for him, in which the Omi Alliance has essentially taken over Kamurocho. And if you're familiar with the kind of rivalry that the Omi and the Tojo clan have had for the last 6+ games, you know, that's a huge deal, right? Like it's massive. And so all of that is kind of unfolding in the background as Ichiban is continually like kicked lower and lower. And all, like you mentioned, you know, Kiryu and some of our previous pro tags even are kind of in the background, and you'll definitely intersect with them kind of later in the game in a way that is epic, but I don't want to spoil too much.
Now, I think my favorite part of the Yakuza series, obviously the super heavy duty, dramatic, you know, operatic crime stuff is cool, but I love all of the weird sub stories and just, you know, side characters you run into along the way. And you and the localization team always seem to have a really good time bringing that stuff to life. Can you talk a little bit about some of the, we saw a lobster on the street at the very beginning of this footage who it seemed like you could talk to. Can you talk about some of just the silly stuff that we're going to be doing in this game in addition to the heavy duty crime drama?
So yeah, you saw that the crawfish over there, her name's Nancy. I don't want to talk too much about Nancy because we will absolutely be showing more of Nancy later, but yes, that involves Ichiban basically making friends with the crawfish, and you know, it's just as bonkers as you might expect Yakuza to be. There's still heartwarming sub stories, there's still very, like, you know, dramatic sub stories, but for the most part the sub stories lean pretty hard into the nonsense side of things. Not to mention all the jobs and special attacks that we're now kind of seeing that, you know, the musician, for instance, having a move called Album Drop, where he literally drops an album on a guy. So
now the other thing that is huge in Yakuza games is all the different sort of mini games and activities. We've seen some of these teas. This has kart racing. Is that right?
Dragon Kart is a full on like a Tokyo. You know, it's very popular in Japan where you like get in those like little go-karts and run around the town. But of course, we had to bring our Yakuza twist to that with rocket launchers and satellites and all that kind of nonsense and machine guns. So that's very much a mini game you can play. I think later in this footage, we're going to show a little bit of Can Quest. You can hop on like a rickshaw and start collecting cans but for a little bit of side income. And that's hilarious. And here we are. Your goal here in this mini game is to collect these cans and get the boosts, and without getting kind of taken out by your competition who's out there also collecting cans, you have to ram them and you have to avoid the garbage truck and the thieves and get back to the goal in time before running out of time to collect your cans.
Are we going to see any of the sort of the business management type of games we've gotten used to? I mean, we've run hostess clubs, we've done real estate and construction companies.
There is a full-on business management mode sub-story happening, and it's just as intricate as Real Estate Royale was, where Ichiban will be tasked with taking over a failing confectionery company and taking that from a literally failing company to a great holdings company, where you'll have to recruit managers, assign them to properties, and go into these really epic like shareholder battles where the shareholders are laying out their grievances and you have to fight them and apologize to them with naturally over the top level of Yakuza nonsense.
that's exactly what I wanted to hear. I mean, the thing about this series that I love is that you wind up latching on to the thing that was you least expected. You know, there'll be some little mini game that you're like, that sounds weird. Who would be into that? And then, you know, you find yourself sinking 11 hours into it and you're like, oops.
Yeah.
Can you, is there going to be any dating? We've seen that kind of got dabbled in Judgment.
Yeah, if you're familiar with the, I guess the Persona series, where you can level your kind of personality up a bit. If you raise certain levels of your personality enough, you might be able to approach some of the ladies you've met throughout the storylines and all that kind of stuff. So it's definitely there. You just have to earn it.
Now you mentioned Persona. That's another Sega property. Obviously, that's kind of the when people think like the turn-based JRPG that Sega makes, that's the big one. And now Yakuza's kind of dipping their toe into that. Have the teams like interacted at all, given each other notes on that kind of thing, or?
That's a great question. They're in the same building. I couldn't tell you, but it's. I think there's definitely some learnings happening, and I think it's just a cool kind of marriage of ideas that's certainly you're seeing with not only Persona but also Like a Dragon.
I love it. Yeah. So I mean, it's interesting to see these sort of parallels. They're both games where you go exploring, in Japan and making friends and fighting stuff. And in this case, it seems like it's definitely dabbling in that JRPG territory, but it's still squarely, Yakuza stuff. Can you talk about sort of it's weird because it doesn't look turn-based. I guess the spacing seems really dynamic and almost more action RPG-ish.
Definitely, it's super snappy. So like you, not only in during battle, you can for one automate as anyone that you'd want to automate. So you can make it incredibly snappy that way. But also, there's this very dynamic kind of live action kind of feel happening where the characters are just kind of they're dancing around each other a little bit. And so like if a character is between you and if a bike is between you and a character, your character will automatically pick up that bike, weave it into his attack. And so like, that happens. And then another character, if you've leveled up your bond via drink links with that character, they will, step in and do a follow-up attack. And, there's action prompts that are like, where you've probably seen them throughout the footage where the character, you'll have to be pressing buttons and you can do perfect guards. And so you are like on your toes at the whole time. It's not a very passive battle system at all. You can, tailor that to be as slow or as fast as you want.
Well, that is awesome. This was, of course, got a big, huge announcement reveal thing at there was the Xbox Series X presentation, direct, state of Xbox, whatever the hell we're calling it. There's too many of these things.
Right.
Everyone's dying to know about next gen. Can you say anything about what people can expect from Yakuza Like a Dragon on the Series X compared to sort of current gen?
We're definitely supporting the smart delivery feature. And outside of that, there's like, we're still figuring that out a little bit, but for the most part, we're ready to support next gen on this, which is going to be pretty cool.
Okay, so when can people expect to get their hands on Yakuza Like a Dragon, Scott?
We'll be there day one on Xbox Series X, Xbox One, PlayStation 4, Windows 10, and Steam.
Wonderful. Well, thank you so much for coming by and chatting. I'm a big fan of Yakuza, as you might have guessed by my suit. I get married in the suit, and I do my Yakuza E3 interviews in this suit. Anyway, thanks for coming by. This has been great. I'm dying to know more about Yakuza Like a Dragon, and it's been a pleasure.
It's been a pleasure, Max. Thank you.
Hey guys, this is TJ Hafer, and I'm bringing you a preview today of A Total War Saga Troy. This is the upcoming game based on the Trojan Wars from Creative Assembly's new Sofia Bulgaria studio. It's centered on, of course, the mythical, semi-historical Trojan Wars. You can see the city of Troy here up on the hill, which will be central to a lot of the conflict. They've sort of taken a truth behind the myth approach, is how they're describing it, in terms of portraying actual history versus the mythology, which we all know from, you know, reading Homer in high school or whatever. So there's not going to be a lot of like overtly supernatural stuff, but there are some nods to that. And then of course we do have the legendary heroes. This is a battle between Achilles on the Achaean Greek side and Hector on the Trojan side. This is the Bronze Age, so warfare is heavily infantry focused, but they've come up with sort of some interesting ways to differentiate units even within that fairly narrow theme. Achilles here has a lot of kind of aggressive, versatile units. He also does have some horsemen, which you're not gonna see a lot of. These guys actually are called centaurs, and they're considered a quote-unquote mythical unit, but they've chosen to represent that by just mounted horsemen, which were not something a lot of people were familiar with at this point of warfare. You can see we got some chariots too, which were a little bit more common. But since, you know, cavalry is going to be pretty rare to the point of actually being considered a mythic unit, they've created different weight classes of infantry. So there's light, medium, and heavy infantry. Heavy infantry will usually win like a one-on-one head-to-head fight, but they have the least mobility. Light infantry are very fast, good at skirmishing. A lot of them have missile weapons and things like that. Here's Hector himself, of course. Heroes are gonna be a big part of it. This is another one of the quote-unquote mythical units. This is the Minotaur, which they're representing as he's some sort of like a barbarian warrior who's just really big and strong and wears a cow skull on his head. Mechanically, they're pretty powerful, probably not as much as the mythic units in, you know, Total War Warhammer or something like that. But they can definitely punch above their weight. Although he is a big dude, so maybe it's at his weight. So we're gonna join the main infantry engagement here. One thing is a lot of these units have alternate weapon modes. So these are Achilles, I think they're called Myrmidons. But I've told them to put their shields away and to two-hand their spears, which gives them a little bit more punching power. And we're running into some of Hector's lighter infantry here that we should be able to make quick work of. But as you can see, he's also using his own light troops to flank us. So we're going to bring in our centaurs here, get a good shot in centaur cam as we intercept these light troops. Yeah, saddles and stirrups were not actually very well developed yet at this point in history. That's part of the reason you didn't see cavalry in the style that we'll see in later time periods, is that it wasn't really practical with the technology we had. Chariots, as you can see here, we don't really want to get stuck in with these, but they're good for like doing run-throughs of enemy light formations. And it looks like over here I've successfully brought in my own missile troops to kind of flank their infantry line. Well, their Minotaur is doing quite a bit of damage to our dudes. I'm hoping that using these missile guys to flank will kind of give us a little bit of an edge in this engagement. And then we'll try to take out Hector here as well, since, you know, if you played Total War for a long time, you know, taking out the enemy commander is usually a pretty good way to spin the battle in your favor. And here we go. Here's Achilles. He's challenged Hector to a duel. It works kind of similar to how it does in Total War Three Kingdoms, where, you know, it's this choreographed fight between these two units, and it's just going to be kind of mano a mano here. One difference is you're not locked into a duel until one side either dies or retreats. It's actually a hero ability with a set duration, so you'll use this challenge ability on an enemy hero, and then you'll be locked into that duel for however long the ability lasts. I mean, if one hero dies first, you know, that'll obviously in the duel, he can't fight back if he's dead. But as you'll see here, the duel actually comes to an end before either of them dies, and then Hector's gonna run off and do his own thing. Achilles is like, wait, no, get back here. Heroes, they've said, are not gonna be quite as powerful as they are in Warhammer, Total War Warhammer, or Total War Three Kingdoms. They're best used fighting on the front line with their troops. And they'll obviously be potent, but you can't win an entire battle with just your heroes. Let's see if we can finish him off here. There we go. Nice stab to the heart. Hector's down. I guess the book is over now. Yep. Anyway, that's our quick preview of A Total War Saga Troy. For more on Total War, check out our preview on the website. And for everything else, keep it right here on IGN.
Devastating storms, economic collapse, rampant disease. Our world can be a terrifying place, but it doesn't have to be. Here at Sangfroid, we have perfected the process of integration. Through this simple procedure, you can preserve the very best part of yourself. The one organ that defines you as you.
You know, I integrated because of you.
We all live with our choices.
Those who didn't resist were shipped off to the Iron Clouds to be Rayon slave soldiers. Those who resisted, well, you all know that story.
Your people should be prepared.
What do you think we should do?
Well, we're in deep already. Tell me what you need.
Surely you don't actually believe in this pathetic cause. But I'm gonna tell you now. I'm offering you true freedom.
I've seen what you call freedom. And the only freedom I want is with these people. My allies, my friends.
Choices, how we might have ended up.
No, I like the hand we've been dealt.
Ah!
destined for something great.
Why did I move here? I guess it was the weather. Or the... I don't know, that thing. That magic.
I thought we was trying to get out of this bullshit.
You sounding more and more like a snee-eyed itch every day. Have you
been to Wonderland? My job! My score! Get your own! All the rides are 50 cents, so take those
ladies off the gym. Haven't had this much fun anyway. We should talk about work.
We out here gangbanging like it's 91.
We all love banks.
Get me a DJ.
Give me a hand with these bodies.
This cannot be traced back to me.
Champagne, anyone?
Just sort of smash things.
So now what?
It was great to kick today off with a look back at just some of the seminal moments of the last 25 years. And what better way to bridge our past and our future than with a game that's graced every PlayStation console, Grand Theft Auto. It's been a privilege partnering with Rockstar Games for many years now, and we're thrilled to open today with the news that that partnership will continue with PlayStation 5. It's now just over a year since we began sharing technical details of PlayStation 5, but today's the day that we've been looking forward to for years, when we get to show you just some of the games that demonstrate our belief that PlayStation 5 marks the biggest generational transition our industry has yet seen. The content we've curated for today's event showcases how PS5 has inspired developers to create new experiences that are transformative in how they look, sound, and feel. Enough from me. We're going to have the games do our talking.
Is just someone who doesn't give up. Your dad said that. He was right. Now it's your turn. Go be a hero, Miles.
Okay. Let's do this.
今日は皆さんに僕らが作っている新しいグランツーリスモの情報をシェアできるということですごく興奮しています。今回のグランツーリスモはおそらくこれまでのねグランツーリスモのファンの方がプレイしたら本当に嬉しいんじゃないかなっていう、まあ、キャンペーンモードを中心にしたグランツーリスモになっていると思います。ぜひ楽しみにしていてください。
You all right back there?
No way. It appears that the dimensions are collapsing on one another. If we cannot get to...
Right. The ship. I mean, we can't be that far.
I have it in my sight.
They have found us, Ratchet.
How do I steer this thing?
Ask nicely.
Slow down, please. That's not listening.
The dimensions are weakening considerably.
How bad is it?
Well, it is certainly not good.
Great!
Where are we?
Beats me.
Ratchet,
We are too late. Ratchet?
Who?
Hi, I'm Marcus Smith, creative director at Insomniac Games. The entire studio is so excited to be able to share with you a first-ever look at Ratchet & Clank Rift Apart, a brand new, full-length, interdimensional adventure built from the ground up for the PlayStation 5. We're doing things we've never been able to do before, like use dimensional rifts to be able to leap from planet to planet nearly instantly, or put ray trace reflections on Clank. All of our alien worlds are filled with density and life previously unseen. Plus, Ratchet's all-new arsenal is more exciting than ever thanks to the DualSense controller's enhanced feedback. Ratchet and Clank are near and dear to our hearts at Insomniac, and we can't wait to share more with you in the future. But for now, here's another look.
Did you see that?
Like my ride, bro?
It's Ratchet and Clank!
Sand shots from above.
Nice sand shark! Nice sand shark! My heroes!
Was that a kraken? Or at least a very large octopus? I will never get used to that.
Hey, break reality.
Don't let him get to the boss!
Did Dr. Nefarious really resurface after all these years just to try and take over the universe again?
Yeah! I kinda wish he was doing a worse job!
He must have more plan than...
That's what I'm afraid of.
Thank you.
Making games used to be about these constant trade-offs between the artistic vision and technical limitations. With PS5, we're not going to be burdened like that. We're going to be able to realize our artistic vision a lot better. It's got a ton of horsepower, which is very easy to unlock, and it's a machine that's really easy to develop on. The PS5 will present a paradigm shift as to what players will come to expect from gaming. Will let us tell stories, make worlds, create gameplay that I think will truly captivate the player and really surprise quite a few people. Please take a look at this new franchise for Worldwide Studios, coming exclusively for PlayStation 5.
Over and over, I relive my first moments on this alien planet. The crash. The attack. My death. The crash. The attack. My death. Trapped in this endless cycle. Even death is no escape. Each time I awake, this planet seems somehow different, as if changing. This world is becoming part of me, infecting my mind, my memories. The longer I spend here, the more I can feel my sanity slip away. But I cannot lose hope. My only choice is to keep fighting. To keep looking for answers. My only hope is to break the cycle. Before the cycle breaks me.
Welcome to London! And our main event, looking to settle some scores and crush anyone in his way, Ultimo Barricado! Challenging him is John and a whole host of heavy hitters.
Hello everyone, my name is Josh Greer, and this is my brother Mike. We're from Ember Lab, a small team with a background in film and animation.
And we're very excited today to share with you the first look at our new game. It's a story full of adventure and charm that has themes in personal growth and redemption. So please enjoy.
You sense the power that flows through this land. Yet, you do not fully understand it. Driven by the belief that you can help these troubled spirits. You cannot hide your weakness from me. You have no power here.
You ever feel like you're just waiting for a sign? To do that thing you've always meant to do. Sometimes I feel like I'm just standing on the edge of doing great things. But something's holding me back. Maybe it's just nerves. Maybe it's the fear that I'll never be as good as what I imagine when I'm still just standing on the edge. But if we've got nothing else to lose, might as well jump.
I'm Lorne Lanning, and I'm here to share with you a game that I've been dying to make. It's an emotionally engaging story where rescuing is rewarding, failure is devastatingly hilarious, and the memories should last you a lifetime. Take a look.
You are no longer a slave. They believed, trusted, followed, and it led them here. You may have escaped the murderous blades, but the fate of your entire people is up to you.
プレイステーション5によって我々の考える東京のビジュアルを実現できました。今までに見たことのない東京の魅力を見て、聞いて、感じることができます。これからお見せするのはゴーストワイヤー東京の世界初のゲームプレイ動画です。スーパーナチュラルでミステリアスな東京、そこに潜む脅威と美しさを感じ取っていただけると思います。ぜひお楽しみください。
You see things others can't. Hear threats others don't. Fight when others won't. It's up to you to save Tokyo.
stretch, no limousine. If you talking winners, gotta intervene. I'm the biggest one that those you ever seen. I'ma need a crown. I'm the only one that ever held it down at the tip top. People flip flop every day, not I. Top five, I'm a big shot. I'm the one that wanna take the big shots. Big bronze, big rings, big rocks, big bag, big moves, big cars, big man, big plan. Get lost in this world. Look at me now, count me down. So give me the crown. Make it wait for the tank.
It was always gonna end like this. All your hard work, all your sacrifice, only sped up the process.
Hakan Abrak here from IO Interactive. In Hitman 3, Agent 47 is back for his most intimate and professional contract in his entire career. This is also the dramatic conclusion for the World of Assassination trilogy. I'm so proud to be here to present a little glimpse of the gameplay where Agent 47 is on top of the world in Dubai. Enjoy.
Thank you.
What's up, everyone? I'm Zion Williamson of the New Orleans Pelicans. Here we go. The first ever teaser for NBA 2K21. Y'all are not ready for this.
You might as well give up now. Think you got a chance, but I don't see how. Got a real tight grip when I hold that crown. I'm the first one in and the last one out. Whoever owns the place gotta drag me out. I don't mean to sound when I strike. You better just run for your life. Run for your life. Run for your life.
Amazing, aren't they? Half bug, half snack. A very recently discovered species, entirely unique to this island. Oh, this one's lively. Beautiful seed patterns. Oh, and it's tasty too. Welcome to the island of bug snacks.
Like a bug and kind of snack. Try to catch and then you'll trap. Feed somebody and you'll see me or whatever we eat.
Awesome.
Find them hiding in the sand. Tearing up a ketchup patch. Come to snack to violence and discover bug snacks. It's bug snacks. Talking about bug snacks.
My invitation is open. Come join me on the island of Bugsnacks.
Liz! I was trying to carry a lamp with my weenie hands, but I dropped it, and now the town's on fire.
Oh, again?
It's Bugsnacks.
Hi everyone, thank you for being with us today for this very special event. But before we get to the end of the show, I have something very near and dear to me.
Deathloop is a next-gen first-person shooter about rival assassins locked in a time loop.
This is our unique vision, what Arkane is all about.
Freeform immersive gameplay, a surreal player-driven story smashed together.
Want to see some stylish action? Check this out.
Making this easy.
Morning, Black Reef. Another day, another death. Aren't time loops fun? For everyone else on this island, this place is paradise. A never-ending party where hunting me is the main attraction. And no matter how I try to escape, they always cut me down. But I'm one stubborn motherfucker. Every loop, I'm learning a little more, piecing together the puzzle. There's 8 targets, and they all gotta die before midnight. There's just one little snag.
You thought it was going to be easy?
Juliana Blake, Black Reef's protector, and a real pain in my ass. She may kill me a million times, but eventually, inevitably, I will break this fucking loop.
I like watching you die. I like killing you. There's a difference.
Long ago, a young girl went with her mother to pick berries for her father, who was hard at work. But the forest greeted them with a dark, cold silence, the bushes empty. Yet determined to find the berries, the rascal broke free of mother's grasp and vanished into the trees. Mother's worried cries faded fast as the girl ran on, over vine, under branch, and into the forest deep.
What is it with that creepy story?
It's just a local tale.
You're really into that stuff?
Quit being so paranoid.
Friendly! Friendly! Who are you? Who sent you? What's going on? They're coming. Who is? Chris?
Sorry, Ethan.
Why?
Freedom. Our freedom.
old ones perished 1,000 years ago. Their great cities turned to graves. In their place came new life. Nothing I wouldn't do to save this world. No depth I won't explore. No secret I won't unlock. No barrier I won't cross. This mission is mine alone. If I falter, if I fail, there won't be anyone left to stop what's coming.
On behalf of the entire team at Guerrilla, we're happy to share the first look at Horizon Forbidden West.
We're continuing Erica's story as she moves west to a far future America.
To brave a beautiful but dangerous frontier, masked with mysterious new threats.
Get ready to explore distant lands ravaged by massive storms.
And take on new, powerful machines as you return
to the majestic world of Horizon.
Stay tuned for much more. We can't wait for you to get your hands on it.
I think there's a lot to look forward to for the community.
I think fans are going to be really pleased.
As a game designer and storyteller, this is incredibly exciting. We're talking a whole new generation of ideas and experiences that we can create for the player.
No matter where they are, no matter who they are.
New experiences like we've never had before.
More iconic, interesting characters. More atmospheric, immersive worlds for players to explore.
We want to wow players.
Expect the unexpected.
And I, for one, can't wait.
We can't wait.
We can't wait to share them with you.
It's so exciting.
Incredibly exciting.
It's really about love
for the players and for the players.
As a developer, that's an amazing feeling to have.
Welcome to PlayStation 5.
Thank you.
We hope you've enjoyed the first glimpse of our future today. You've seen our most striking console design yet, and you've seen games that can only be enjoyed with the full range of PlayStation 5's features and power. At PlayStation, we believe in generational transitions, and we put years of work into making them happen. We want you to enjoy the unique benefits of moving from one generation to the next. Thank you for joining us. We're launching later this year, and we have tons more to share. Welcome to PlayStation 5.
PlayStation.
Princess Peach's castle has been seized by origami. The sudden appearance of King Ollie, the Origami King, has thrown the world into disarray. And so, in the paper-crafted universe of the Paper Mario series, a new quest to reclaim Peach's castle begins. Paper Mario, the Origami King. Mario sets out on his latest journey around the world, searching for the ends of five massive streamers that have unfurled from Peach's castle. A forest spring, an autumn mountain, a ninja-filled mansion, an underground sewer system, a desert oasis. Untold trials await Mario in an array of captivating landscapes. Wielding mighty paper techniques, you'll help Mario unfold new paths, explore vast regions, unlock the secrets of an ancient ruin, brave the raging rapids, take center stage, go island hopping, appear on a quiz show, and even duke it out in an aerial battle. And what's an adventure without companions to share it with? Meet Olivia, Mario's steadfast travel companion. However, she's also King Ollie's sister. Determined to foil her brother's plans, this bright young lady helps Mario out of all sorts of jams. During Mario's journey, he'll cross paths with a variety of characters. A Bob-omb who's lost his memory. A Toad professor of ancient history. And the Magic Koopa with a penchant for cleaning? Kamek. Some of them will even aid in battling Mario's enemies. Make contact with an enemy, and a battle begins. This grid of rings is the stage on which battles will unfold. A fresh take on Paper Mario battles. You'll first want to arrange enemies in advantageous positions to turn the tide of battle in your favor. These enemies may look like they're scattered at random, but spin like this, and slide like that, and voila, they're all lined up. Choose the right weapon for the job, then attack. Stomp on foes, or hammer them home. The key to victory lies in whether you can get the enemies in line before time runs out. Use items like the Fire Flower, the Tail, and the Power Block to take down your foes. Classic Mario style. And while regular battles offer a great challenge, boss battles really up the ante. The menacing members of the Legion of Stationery guard the ends of the streamers in each region, presenting the sharp set of 12 colored pencils, followed by the big, bouncy body of rubber band, and the stout, shifty, and sticky tape to cap things off. These frightening foes each attack with their particular penchant for pulverizing paper. Unlike regular battles, in boss battles, you'll spin and slide the ring grid and build a path for Mario to reach his destination. Guide Mario along a route that will let him deliver a blistering attack. Locate your adversary's weak point and tear them to shreds. Throughout this vast world, you'll find poor toads who had their forms altered by the Origami King. This is a toad. This is also a toad. And, yep, you guessed it, a toad. And who knows, finding all these toads might just prove to be worth your while. You can also toss confetti to repair holes torn in the landscape. Investigate suspicious spots to find hidden items. And try your hand at fun minigames to earn in-game rewards. Leave no page unturned as you travel the world in search of secrets and treasures. The Origami King's pernicious plot is unfolding. It's up to Mario to set things right. Paper Mario, the Origami King.
exclusive.
Consider your predicament. One skull, two tenants, and no solution in sight. I could fix it all like that. Try to cure yourself. Shop around. Beg, borrow, and steal. Exhaust every possibility until none are left. And when hope has been whittled down to the very marrow of despair, that's when you'll come knocking on my door.
Hi everybody, and welcome to community update number 3 for Baldur's Gate 3. I have great news today. We finally locked down our early access content and we decided that we're going to bring Baldur's Gate 3 for the very first time in your hands in August 2020. That's to say, maybe. And the maybe has everything to do, of course, with COVID-19. We've been hit like everybody else in the world. We've been working from home, which wasn't necessarily the easiest thing as game developers, because we like to huddle around the monitor and discuss about the things that are happening in the game. But nonetheless, we managed to make a lot of progress since you last saw the game at PAX East. So we think we're going to make it, depending on a couple of things. One of these things, for instance, is our performance capturing and motion capturing. Our people have started returning to the office. We've been recording again. And if we can hit a certain speed in the recording, then we should be able to make it. The game is looking amazing. It is absolutely incredible to see how much progress has been made since PAX East. And I think when you'll see it, you'll understand what I'm talking about. The visual fidelity has increased a lot. And the cool part is that actually we're going to launch a game in August in early access, but we still have an entire development period to go after that. So it's going to look even better by the time it's going to release. You will see things like improvement in combat. We did a lot of changes in how combat flows, how the camera moves, how the initiative system works. All together, they make for a much more refined combat experience, which is a lot of fun, I can tell you that. There are changes in the way that we do our narrator. That was something that we had a lot of feedback on. There's the integration of the rule set is getting better and better. So we were getting a really good handle on how to do things. And so it feels like a really, really cool game with a lot of depth when you play it now. Here's the really cool part. You don't have to wait until August 2020 to see what I'm talking about, because we'll do another gameplay live stream and we'll do it just in front of Dungeons & Dragons Live on June 18th. And you will decide for me whether or not I'm going to kill a hobgoblin who deserves to be killed, his name is Dror Raxxin, or if I'm going to descend into the Underdark. I'm very much looking forward to it, so I hope to see you there on June 18th. It's going to be a lot of fun. Take care, bye-bye.
Peggy 16.
Oh, silver-tongued Odysseus, there is only one response to Queen Helen's abduction, and that is war.
In Total War Saga Troy, you can rewrite the events of one of the greatest conflicts ever told, the Trojan War. As Odysseus besieged the legendary city of Troy in 3 ingenious and equally devastating ways, all based around prominent theories from throughout the ages as to what the iconic Trojan horse really resembled.
The walls of this city may appear to be mighty, but no defenses are impregnable.
Using gargantuan siege towers, take the fight to the walls. Slaughter the Trojans atop and force them back into their pitiful city.
The enemy are unaware of your presence. Position your troops to retain your advantage once the attack begins.
sneak troops into the city in a vast horse-headed vessel fit for the gods. Under the cloak of darkness, use guerrilla tactics to sabotage the unbreachable city gates, leaving the Trojan warriors defenseless, allowing the Achaean soldiers to begin razing the city to the ground.
Their walls have been breached.
Even the greatest defenses cannot stand against nature's might. In a land ravaged by earthquakes, patience is rewarded. Send your troops forward. Troy is yours for the taking. Myth meets history in a war that will define the ages. Experience the legend of Troy this summer.
Victory will make you immortal.
Hey, Tommy. Detective Narvin.
How long you been in town?
3 years.
They handed you the Morello case. Right out of the gate.
That's what the paper says, ain't it? And what's it to you?
Case must be getting pretty cold by now.
Or you got something might warm it up?
Yeah. I might have something. Thomas. Thomas Angelo, sir.
Man, DevBot, after a beautiful trailer like that, I gotta know, do you have any contacts in the Mafia?
Sean, I have left that life behind me. I am programmed not to form relationships with organized crime. However, I can call one of the developers of Mafia Definitive Edition.
Well, fantastic. Let's ring him up, DevBot. Joining me to talk about Mafia is the president and CCO of Hangar 13. It is Hayden Blackman. Hayden, thanks so much for joining us today.
Thanks for having me.
So for people who haven't played the original Mafia, which is a 2002 release, talk to us about this game.
Mafia, the Definitive Edition, is a complete ground-up remake of Mafia from 2002, which is a seminal game that really launched the Mafia franchise. And in Mafia, you take on the role of Tommy Angelo, who is a cab driver that falls in with the mob during the 1930s, actually during the height of Prohibition, in a city called Lost Heaven, which is loosely based on Chicago. And as a member of the Salieri crime family, he really gets embroiled in a war with the Morello crime family, and we kind of explore that story and Tommy's evolution from cab driver to a respected member of the Mafia.
I feel like in the last 10 years, we've seen HD editions, remasters that are more graphical updates. But my understanding is that this is far more than just a new coat of paint on a game from 2002. Talk to me about what a remake means.
Everything was rebuilt. So every asset, every cinematic was reshot, and all the gameplay was completely redone. Now, we've kept all the same big beats from the original game. The story is the same for the most part. All the big plot points are there. All the missions are there and represented. But again, everything was completely rebuilt from the ground up. In order to kind of meet the expectations of today's gamers and take advantage of today's technology.
The location in pretty much every open world game is a central character. In 2002, we have seen a ton of gameplay changes between then and now, 2020. Can you talk a little bit about some of the ways you've updated the open world setting and maybe some of the new mechanics that players can expect?
So we do that a number of different ways. You know, one, we looked at how populated can we make it, and we took some of the kind of world interactions and some of the things that we did with, crowds and non-player characters and other kind of city life from Mafia 3 and put them into Mafia the Definitive Edition. But we also looked at, are there ways for us to kind of redesign the city so it's more fun to drive around? Do we need to widen the streets? Do we need to make sure that there's not as many, 90-degree turns so that you can kind of coast around corners? And as we capture the feel of the vehicles, are there things that we want to do to make sure that the roads have, grip or they're slick in the rain? And so that, I think, brought a lot of life to it as well, because most of the way that you engage with the city is through driving.
I mean, speaking of rebuilding things from the ground up, I got to ask you about the cinematics. I mean, they looked gorgeous in the trailer.
Yeah.
And I mean, what was the process of rebuilding all of those cinematics?
For us, it was really, you know, how do we recreate these, again, taking advantage of some of the cutting edge stuff that we've been doing at Hangar 13. So, you know, we have, you know, really great facial scanning and likeness capture technology, a state-of-the-art mocap facility. So we really wanted to take advantage of that for, you know, the definitive edition. So we did go in and we rewrote all the cinematics, again, to add some of that language and add some of that character development and maybe some of that clarity that we were going for, without losing the essence of each moment.
Well, now it's time for my favorite question.
Yeah.
When can we play Mafia Definitive Edition, and where can people go right now to learn more?
Sure. So we are looking at an August 28th launch date, and we still, you know, have a ways to go, and we're working on that kind of final polish push right now, but I'm really confident, really bullish in that date right now. If you want more information, you can go to mafiagame.com.
After seeing the trailer, I personally am hyped, Hayden. Thank you so much for joining us at this year's PC Gaming Show. Once again, mafiagame.com.
Fully operational, sir.
Excellent. Bring in the other subjects.
Exclusive.
These are not words I wish to write. I fear you may believe me taken with madness. My father seeks to use me. He wishes me to sing for him as she did. To become the star attraction that will draw good folk to this accursed spit of land. I cannot explain further, but ask that you trust me. Your love, always, Elizabeth.
Hello, my name is Ben Tester, and I'm head of marketing at Wells Interactive. Right now we're finishing work on a new title, Made of Scare, and we're really excited to be able to share with you this new and exclusive gameplay footage. Made of Scare is a first-person survival horror game, which features a story inspired by Welsh folklore. It fuses psychological, gothic, and British horror. Set in 1898, Made of Scare is inspired by the haunting Welsh tale of Elizabeth Williams. It's a story of a family empire that's driven by torture, slavery, piracy, and a supernatural mystery that suffocates the grounds of the hotel. In this footage, we wanted to explore the 3D sound-based AI system that is the core survival mechanic. We want to show you what you can do to remain undetected, and if you're caught, what tools are available for you to survive. The enemies at Scare Hotel are completely blind, and they hunt by only what they can hear. So any noise that you make from walking or running, bumping into environmental objects, or even breathing heavily will often result in death. So you can avoid detection by creeping, avoiding the obstacles that make the noise, but if the enemies are close, then holding your breath is the only option. If you mistime this and run out of breath, then even your panting will get you killed. You are not completely defenseless. There'll be a sound-based weapon available with limited ammo that's hidden in and around the grounds of the hotel. You'll have to find health items, collectibles, puzzle pieces, map pieces, and story pickups, all items that you can find and add to your inventory. The game will feature three levels of difficulty. The scares remain the same throughout, but a change in AI behavior, enemy strength, limited manual saves, and reduced ammo and health items will put more of an emphasis on that classic survival horror experience. Made of Scare is coming to PC and console, with a digital and physical launch on PS4 and Xbox One this July. You can wishlist the game now on Steam, and pre-purchase will be available in the coming weeks. Thank you for joining us, and we hope you enjoy the show.
Exclusive.
Rated M for Mature.
Please come in, Miss Reed. Come in.
Good evening, Mr. Ashman. Do you remember me?
Only between old friends.
I'm Jennifer, by the way. Lindsay? But call me Lynn.
At last.
It's just a bad dream.
Where are you? Show yourself!
With the axe!
What have you done to her?
You won't do it, Mr. Ashman.
Of course I will.
Not one step further. See what we've got. 5 integrated outlaws.
Sir, have you got weapons and shelter in there? Maybe you could give us a chance to rest.
We may have more of interest to you than guns.
Hi there, my name's Marcus Leto. I'm the president and creative director at V1 Interactive, and we are currently working on our brand new debut game called Disintegration. And we are super excited to finally be getting ready for it to launch soon.
Wow, look at you. Yeah, I guess you took the hard road.
With Disintegration, we set out to build something truly unique. It blends some great parts of a first-person shooter with a real-time tactical elements in a way that's never been done before, and in a way that required us to invent all new gameplay mechanics in order for it to work.
Core B dropped.
The story of Disintegration is something that's set about 150 years from now in the future, where humanity's really struggling to survive. And one means of survival is taking the human brain and actually implanting it within an armored shell and attaching that to a robotic armature, allowing them to survive through this period of time. Once in these robotic armatures, humans now find themselves in a world where they are super strong, they're super durable, and some of them don't want to return back to humanity again. And so a new army is developed called the Rayon. In this world, we play some of those early integrated who are fighting back and who don't want to follow along with the Rayon.
I've seen what you call freedom. Not interested.
In Disintegration's multiplayer, we allow the players to team up 5v5 against one another, each with their own crew in this incredible battle against one another. Each one of those matches takes place in a different type of game mode, so there's a great variety of things to hop into.
Victory!
In order for the player to really have success playing Disintegration, they need to consider both parts of the equation. On one hand is your grab cycle and your weapons and abilities that you use fluidly in combat. That's just one part of the equation, though. On the other hand is your ground squad, each with their unique abilities that you can fire off tactically in gameplay. It's important that the player understands that both of these things work in tandem together and that they are part of a whole. They are the crew. And for you to kind of consider both parts is critical for your success. So Disintegration is finally going to be released on June 16th on PlayStation 4, the Xbox One, and Steam, well, for the PC. We're excited to be on all three platforms simultaneously, and we are eagerly waiting for the community to hop in and start playing with us.
I'm sorry. Were you two having a moment? I can leave y'all be.
What? The grav cycle? I'm a pilot.
Uh-huh.
It's called a pre-flight inspection.
No judgments here, huh?